So recently, there has been some really huge and devastating earthquakes in Turkey and Syria, and I have been getting asked, why can't we predict earthquakes? And will we ever be able to? In this video, I'm going to talk about what earthquakes are, what causes them, where earthquakes occur, a little bit about the Turkey and Syria earthquakes and why they were so severe, whether we can predict earthquakes and the difference between predictions, early warnings, forecasts, and probabilities, and why we can't predict earthquakes. Spoiler alert, we cannot predict earthquakes. And lastly, I'll talk about ways that we are trying to predict earthquakes in the future, or at least make it possible to predict earthquakes in the future to some extent, whereas right now we really can't predict earthquakes at all. So, first things first, what causes earthquakes, or basically, what are earthquakes? Well, stress is placed on rocks by the weight of other rocks, and over time it builds up and can sometimes cause rocks to break. And those breaks are called fractures. And then when there's slip along that break, along that plane of the fracture, then it's called a fault. And when stress builds up along fault planes, it eventually causes the fault to slip all of a sudden after the stress overcomes the friction between the two rock blocks holding the fault plane together. The sudden movement of slip along faults produces seismic waves that propagate through Earth's layers. Now, briefly, some terminology so you understand what I talk about later in the video. The hypocenter or focus of the earthquake is the point where the earthquake is generated, and it is located along the fault, which can be beneath the Earth's surface, but can also be at Earth's surface, depending on where the slip begins along that fault. But most earthquakes have hypocenters located less than 100 kilometers deep. The epicenter, however, is the point at Earth's surface directly above the hypocenter. So it is not necessarily along the fault plane, but it can be. And in those cases, it is basically the same as the hypocenter. From the hypocenter, seismic waves propagate out in all directions through the rock layers. From the epicenter at Earth's surface, seismic waves then propagate out along the surface, and we feel all of these waves when we feel earthquakes. Although most earthquakes are caused by faults slipping, there are some caused by other things like volcanoes, for example. The explosive eruptions can cause seismic waves, just like fault slipping. Landslides can also cause seismic waves and thus earthquakes. Explosions like mine blasts, nuclear explosions, and/or fracking. Fracking is kind of the same thing as fault slip earthquakes because what fracking does is it lubricates fault planes within the earth because we're putting fluids down there that then allow slip to occur along faults that are already present within Earth. Now, obviously, for these types of earthquakes, predictions can be possible. For example, if we're fracking in an area, we might be able to say, look, guys, there may be an earthquake if we lubricate a fault that's down there. Impacts are another thing that can cause earthquakes. And if we see that a meteor is going to impact Earth, then we might be able to say that we should expect earthquakes from that. Or if we know that a volcano is erupting, or if we know that conditions are such that landslides are imminent in certain areas, we can predict that earthquakes may occur in those situations. But we will focus today on why we cannot predict fault-caused earthquakes, which are the typical, big devastating earthquakes along tectonic boundaries and such. So we will talk about fault-caused earthquakes for the rest of the video. Now, friction along the fault allows stress to build up over time, and that is called the pre-slip period. And then eventually, again, like I mentioned earlier, stress overcomes the friction along the fault, and that causes slip. This is when the earthquake is generated. Post-slip, or after the slip happens, stress is reduced along the fault because all that stress and energy built up during the pre-slip period was released. This allows what's called elastic rebound along the fault plane, which kind of elastically brings it back to a, normal stationary state. And that begins the next pre-slip period or next period of stress buildup along the fault plane before it then slips again once stress overcomes the new friction along the fault. Now, note here, that the fault has a new position post-slip. Thus, the degree of friction has changed, and therefore the amount of stress that it can handle before it slips again has also changed, and that makes the duration until the next slip event very difficult to predict. So this is one of the reasons it's really hard to predict fault-caused earthquakes. And note here that we define the hypocenter as a point, not the whole plane of the fault, because the fault doesn't slip all at once. The earthquake begins to slip at the hypocenter, but then propagates out. This propagation is called rupturing, and it stops once the stress is no longer greater than the friction along the fault. When the rupturing stops, the earthquake stops. This is why, in general, larger faults that allow longer rupturing cause potentially larger and more damaging earthquakes. So let's talk a little bit about the pattern of earthquakes, the geographical pattern of earthquakes, because that kind of explains how they occur as well as what makes them so severe. So first, why are most earthquakes associated with continental margins? Well, this is typically where tectonic plates meet, and these plate boundaries cause a lot of stress and therefore a lot of movement along those faults because the plates are either pushing against each other or pulling away from each other. We can see the trends here are along active tectonic margins. For example, there is active subduction going on at the western, North, and South American continental margins, but there is not along their eastern margins. That's why there are not many earthquakes going on along those non-tectonically active margins, but there are along the active ones. Second, why are earthquakes deeper, further inland, and shallower at the margin? Subducting plates sink deeper as they go further inland, and therefore, the deeper the tectonic plates sink, the deeper the hypocenters will be of the earthquakes that are caused in that region. Right at the margin where the plate is just at the surface and starting to subduct under the continental plate, that's where you get pretty shallow earthquakes. And as you can see here, the shallow earthquakes are actually higher in magnitude. So it's important to remember deeper does not equal larger. In fact, deep earthquakes cause less shaking at the surface because their hypocenter is further away. Larger earthquakes are at the accretionary wedge where most of the faulting is occurring. And subduction zone earthquakes specifically are very damaging because they can cause tsunamis. The shallow depth of the Turkey and Syria earthquakes is what caused the intense shaking that caused so much damage in this region. The East and Anatolian fault system is part of a triple junction where three tectonic plates are grinding against each other. Because this triple junction is so complex and involves so many faults, not just three boundaries, but each boundary is associated with a lot of faults within its system, that's what causes so many aftershocks after an earthquake occurs in this region. All of the faults are affected by the large slip of one singular fault in that system, and so they all have to reshift after that one fault slips to readjust themselves to the new stress regime. And I'll show you guys later a map of all the aftershocks that occurred, or at least to our knowledge, have occurred after the first large earthquake in this region. Later in the video, I think it's estimated right now to have been over 60 aftershocks, at least. Since 1970, only three magnitude 6 or greater earthquakes have occurred in this region, and thus many geologists were suggesting that it was overdue for a large earthquake. But why couldn't they have predicted where exactly and when exactly it was going to occur? Well, this leads us to the question, can we predict earthquakes? And the answer is just simply no. According to the USGS, earthquake predictions must define the when, the where, and the how big an earthquake will be. But right now, we can only vaguely estimate the probability of earthquakes in certain regions within certain windows of time. For this, scientists have put together earthquake probability maps or hazard maps, whatever you want to call them, showing what regions are most at risk within a certain time range, but it's still very vague. Now, before I get into why we can't predict earthquakes, let me just define the difference between predictions and early warnings, as well as some other terms that are often used that might be confused with predictions, but they're not predictions. Early warnings for earthquakes are issued after an earthquake starts. We use earthquake monitoring systems to alert people when waves are generated by an earthquake and are expected to arrive at their location. Even the seconds to tens of seconds of advanced warning that this provides can save many lives. There's also a term called earthquake forecasts, but earthquake forecasts are not predictions of earthquakes. They're generally applied to aftershocks. Aftershocks tend to follow a similar pattern, and the probability of an aftershock in a time window following an earthquake can be determined, and that is what we call an earthquake forecast, or what we typically use that term for. We also use the term earthquake probabilities, but these describe long-term chances that an earthquake of a certain magnitude will occur within a certain time window, kind of like that map I was showing earlier, the kind of probability or degree of hazard map. But these, again, are not predictions. These probabilities are made based on the average rate of historical events or estimated fault slip rates if historical event data is not available. However, like I mentioned earlier, because the rates of slip along a certain fault plane can change drastically between slip events, these rates are often incredibly inconsistent and result in very high uncertainties. So probabilities don't even get us close to the when, where, and how big the earthquake will be type of prediction. So why can't we predict earthquakes? Well, again, earthquakes strike without warning because faults are locked up and stationary and therefore silent until slip begins. And this means seismologists cannot measure any signals before the earthquake begins. And once it begins, it's already going so quickly that, yeah, we're trying to send out early warnings about the readings that we're getting about the earthquake, but it only provides seconds to tens of seconds of warning. It's not a prediction. Hazard maps like the global one I showed earlier and the US one from USGS here are the closest we come to quote-unquote predictions. Since we can't exactly say when such estimated or probable events will occur, efforts by earthquake scientists are typically focused on improving infrastructure or improving our planning for events with rapid alert systems, evacuation plans, etc. But infrastructure, or building and rebuilding buildings to be earthquake tolerable, is really costly. The buildings in Turkey and Syria, for example, were not earthquake prepared. Thus, scientists are trying to make earthquake predictions more accurate and precise. If you don't know the difference between accuracy and precision, it matters here because we can make predictions that may be precise but are in no way accurate. And at the same time, we can make predictions that are accurate but in no way precise. But we need both when it comes to earthquake predictions, because being off on either one of these could be detrimental to, you know, human lives and the economy, many, many things. Foreshocks, or, you know, pre-earthquake seismic signals, are not often observed in nature. I say in nature here because they have been observed in some lab-produced earthquake simulations, but in nature, there's a lot of noise, a lot of seismic noise, because Earth is constantly grumbling and rumbling, and there's also not only natural but anthropogenic seismic clatter, like traffic, construction, etc. So it's hard to pick out clear signals that are actually foreshocks. So we try to look to other potential precursors than just seismic data. For example, animal behavior. Animals often respond to electrical disturbances in Earth's atmosphere that may be precursors to earthquakes. There's also potential precursor changes to Earth's ionosphere that we could measure before earthquakes happen and predict them at least days before they happen rather than seconds. And potentially the most promising of these precursor type detection systems is AI detection of subtle signals that humans miss. Machine learning algorithms can look for patterns in the vast amounts of data from past earthquakes to predict future events. So far, AI can predict when failure is going to occur in lab-simulated earthquakes based on changes in elastic properties and noise coming from foreshocks in a fault zone. What does that mean? Well, it means that it potentially works to predict earthquakes in lab-based simulations, but transferring this use of AI to the complex real-world fault zones that are causing natural earthquakes is not easy. Because again, like I mentioned earlier, it's not just one fault plane, like maybe a simple simulation, but it's got many, many faults in the system, and there are many, many other factors that are occurring in nature that aren't necessarily acting upon the lab-based earthquake. But as we get better at models and simulations and including all of these factors, we might find a way to transfer this use of AI to the real world. But based on what I've read, it seems like we have a long way to go. AI might not only be able to predict earthquakes, but also might be useful after earthquakes occur. By assessing building damage and identifying dangerous structures, it can help us be able to send rescue teams where they're most needed faster. It may also help rescue workers and survivors of earthquakes by better predicting aftershocks and getting those people to safer locations if aftershocks are predicted. This is extremely important because aftershocks can be even more dangerous than the initial earthquake because they can demolish buildings that were left unstable by the initial earthquake. As you can see here in this map of Turkey and Syria, in the recent earthquake that occurred there, there were over 60 aftershocks recorded. So moving forward, what should we do? Probably focus on preparation. Obviously, scientists are working their best to improve predictions and make predictions more possible with certain precursor type events that they can measure. But obviously, preparation is like the major thing that we know we can do because we know that earthquakes will happen and we know the parts of the world that are most vulnerable. So we just need to build accordingly. It is extremely sad to watch the footage of the devastation in Turkey and Syria, but it can also be helpful. There are clues in the buildings that are still standing directly next to the buildings that were demolished. And so if we take these clues and use them to build better infrastructure that is more earthquake tolerable, then we can potentially save millions of lives. If you want to check out my references for this video, they will be linked in my description box below. I know this video is a little sad, but I hope if anything, we can learn from these situations moving forward and, you know, do better. Obviously, rebuilding entire cities is really costly, but, you know, we need to do it because predictions right now are not possible and they won't be for a long time. Anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed and I will see you guys in my next video. Bye.